So it's been roughly 1 year since I started on YouTube. I posted my first video in mid-December of 2020, and I kind of can't believe that it's now December 2021, and here I am, still posting videos. So today I thought I would just share a bit about my journey, about how I got started on YouTube, how it's been going. I also thought I would just talk about starting new endeavors and if anybody here might be interested in starting their own channel or has recently started a channel. I might give a few ideas about what has been successful for me, what hasn't. I think we learn most from failures, and I've definitely had a lot of failures along the way. So learn from my mistakes, don't make the same ones. And then I'll also share at the end some gear and what my kit includes for those of you who are really serious about starting a channel. And so I want to share those ideas for gear at the end of the video as well. So first off, why did I start a YouTube channel? What prompted me to do that? And to be honest, I'm not exactly sure. I think sometimes in life there's an inevitability to decisions, and this just kind of happened. Like, I don't even remember specifically deciding I'm gonna shoot my first YouTube video. Like, I remember when I started doing it, but I don't actually know when I made the decision to start. It just kind of organically came about. It was during COVID. I was, you know, living pretty much in isolation. I was working from home, so I was spending a lot of time just indoors doing nothing. And I tend to be someone who likes to be social, likes to hang out with friends. And so I thought this could just be a fun outlet for some of that energy that I wasn't expending elsewhere. I really enjoyed YouTube videos. I'd learned a lot on YouTube. I'd learned skills on YouTube. I'd learned ideas on YouTube. So I came from a place of really enjoying the medium and sort of the authenticity of a lot of YouTube videos, just people being real and vulnerable with people miles away. I liked that whole principle. And then I also think, I mean, I was doing videography work and shooting weddings and doing work for small companies. And I just thought this was another area for me to just practice my video skills and my audio skills and also do something that's creative where I can think of ideas and talk about principles, keep me accountable on my minimalism journey, and then also just discuss psychological principles that I'm working on in my own life. I definitely think it was a way for me to organize my thoughts on how I'm trying to improve myself, but I didn't really even think of it as a space where I was really sharing it with other people. I think implicitly, maybe there was some of that, but I honestly came into it thinking that I was not gonna have any views. I honestly didn't think anyone would ever know about this channel. I purposely didn't associate my full name with it. I just wanted to kind of keep it to myself, and I really wasn't promoting it anywhere in my personal life. I didn't even tell most of my family members about it. It was really just a hobby for me to practice some skills, to think about some concepts, to do something creative in my spare time. It's so weird looking back. I was acting so impostery, like my imposter syndrome was running haywire, because why would I assume that no one would ever watch my videos and that it would remain totally private? Like, I thought maybe one or two people might happen across it and watch it and it might help them, but I really didn't think that people would be like commenting and I'd be slowly growing a channel. Like, I truly just, no way did I think that was gonna happen at all. So over time, I started getting a few views, and then eventually my channel got monetized and I started getting opportunities for sponsorships and that type of thing. And it started to become a source of income for me. But more importantly, it became a place where I could express myself and be myself. And I think it's rare to really find that, and to find that in a space where maybe a few people listen. I personally have learned so much from many other channels, and even on a more human level, I really enjoy watching YouTube because I feel like I often connect with the person I'm watching. And so it's a nice thought to think that, like, maybe out there somewhere I'm connecting with some of you. It's just that human thing. Like, it's a space where I can talk and be myself, and it's okay. So that's kind of how I got started. It just organically grew. And not that it's the biggest channel ever. There are certainly channels that have blown up to be far bigger than mine, much more quickly than mine. But I've really enjoyed the community that's gradually developed, and I hope to continue to develop it. I do work a full-time job as a podcast producer, and I've historically done a lot of videography. Before that, I did get my PhD in clinical psychology, so I'm kind of all over the place, but I definitely see this YouTube channel as something that I continue to pursue. So now that I told you a little bit about my process, I thought I would just give a few pieces of advice based on, again, my past failures or my insecurities. So if you're thinking of starting a YouTube channel, my first recommendation would be to not be a perfectionist, to just start creating content and start putting it out there. It's so easy to create videos and think they're not good enough, whether it be because of the production value or because you just think you sound awkward or you feel weird on camera. I certainly do sometimes. But if you don't just start putting it out there, you'll never get anywhere. And I think this is one piece of advice that probably translates beyond just YouTube videos. If you don't just take the risk that you might fail, that you might look silly, that it doesn't succeed, then you're never gonna get anywhere. And I actually think that some of my worst videos, I'm still very proud of. Well, I don't know about proud of, actually, but I'm proud of myself for putting them out there and just doing it, even if they weren't perfect, and even if people could come in and say, you know what, you left a breath in there for the audio editing, which, you know, I shouldn't do considering I work in podcasting. I don't know, all the little things that people could criticize me on. I do also get criticism. I get plenty of comments that are negative and disparaging and give advice for how I could improve my channel, and I try to learn from those comments. When they're extra harsh or a little bit cruel, I've learned to just not really need to give them my time of day. And I think if I went into this wanting to never have a negative reaction or never have anyone judge me a little bit for it, I wouldn't be successful. Or I just wouldn't have even made the channel. And I wouldn't have this outlet that's creatively really fun for me and that is also now a source of income for me. I wouldn't have that if I didn't just jump in and do it. So that is my first and perhaps biggest piece of advice. Just the more you produce content and put it out there, the more likely you are to be successful. It's kind of like that thing, if you have to write something, you can either write it haphazardly and then edit later, or you can try to perfect every word as you go. I think though, if you try to perfect every word as you go, you're only looking at it from one perspective, the perspective of like, I'm on the road to writing this as opposed to looking back and being able to see it as a whole. And so I truly believe that like create things and then edit later, fix it later. Yeah, I think that's really, really important. My second tip would be to find something that you're excited about, that you're genuinely passionate about or that you care about, and do the research. Picking a topic for your channel is, I think, really important because you end up having to create the same content over and over again eventually and find all these little tendrils of the topic that you can go down and keep it interesting, not only for your audience, but for yourself. And so make sure that you're picking a topic that is truly interesting and exciting to you. And I do think it's important to have some kind of topic or niche because otherwise, it's hard to grow a following. Like I even think the YouTube algorithm won't know who to send your videos to, like what audience to be projecting your videos onto. And so I definitely think that having a niche is important, but make sure it's one that you're excited about that interests you. And definitely do the research, read up on it, inform yourself, take the time to think about it and to reflect on your own new ideas in the area. For me, I knew that I was pursuing minimalism, that it was something I wasn't naturally good at. I tend to like to collect, but I was really excited about the idea of minimalism beyond just the stuff level. On a more philosophical level, creating space in my life for what I care about really resonated with me, and so I wanted to pursue it. I also knew it was something that maybe people would be interested in, although again, I didn't necessarily come at this from an angle of I'm gonna grow as a channel, but I thought, it's something that interests me. It's something that I can pursue. And then I also wanted to think about empowering people, especially because I do have a background and an interest in psychology and in research and having that inform how we navigate this world. And so I thought, you know what? I have a perspective on that. I've studied psychology for years. I've researched it. I've given therapy, and I can give some of those ideas to other people as I'm also trying to empower myself and gaining confidence. I did far more research into minimalism and into psychology and prepping for videos. So I definitely think that doing that extra work is important. And that's where being interested in the topic is also important. My third tip is to be original. And I know this one is actually kind of difficult in that there are infinite videos, it seems, on YouTube. I do think a lot of my content isn't necessarily the most original, but I do think that the videos that are most successful on my channel are those that are a little bit more unique to me and that aren't necessarily a strategic video that like a lot of people do. Like they're actual ideas I came up with. And so yes, of course, if you're making a YouTube channel, if there's a type of video that's common, like say a routine video that you want to do, go for it. It never hurts. But I definitely think that often the most successful videos are those that are authentic to you and that organically came from your ideas and what's unique about you. You have a perspective and you just have to figure out what's special about it and what do you have to give? What's that weird thought in the back of your head that maybe you've never really shared with anyone, but that has some truth in it that you want to share with the world? Start there and figure out how you can create a new or original idea for a video. My fourth tip is that after getting started and just putting content out there, spend some time trying to improve the quality of your videos, whether it be through more B-roll, whether it be through improving your gear a bit. I definitely think when you're first getting started, even just using your phone to shoot things totally works. You know, just get going. But then once you get going, spend the time to try to improve the quality of the videos. I do have a tip with this here. As you start to improve your channel, I think one of the first things to invest in is better sound quality. And the reason for that is that I think it's the sound that makes a video feel more expensive. Basically, if you have great visuals but bad sound, the quality of the video will just seem less and worse than if you have really good sound and mediocre visuals. Like, I truly believe, even though we don't think of it that way, because I think with social media, we're primed to think that the visuals are the most important thing at projecting yourself, I truly believe that the sound makes a huge difference. And I think even doing things like, I have a blanket up over here on the wall, I have pillows out on this desk in front of me. I also know I can tell there's even still with all this a slight echo that's probably annoying in this video, so I'm a little worried about that. But I have my microphone right here in front of me and doing everything I can to improve the sound quality and invest in that gear, I think can be a great next step once you're getting started. Also, if you're worried about visual, focus on just improving the lighting, not having harsh light on you, but having really diffused light that kind of comes from all areas. For example, a really good tip is to use bounce back light. So point your lights actually away from you. That's what I do, so that it bounces off the walls and hits you in kind of a diffuse way as opposed to a harsh way. Or even use a window. I'm using a window right now. There's a window in front of me that's helping with the light. But all in all, just gradually try to improve the quality of the videos and you'll continue to improve. My fifth tip is to find the fun in it. Don't get bogged down in too many specific goals and just making sure you hit every number or something. Don't worry about the metrics or looking at the analytics. I mean, definitely they're informative. I think they're helpful. But I think the most important thing is finding the fun in the process of creating videos. What do you enjoy about it? Is it creating the ideas? Is it shooting? Is it editing? I think for me, the most fun is thinking of the ideas and then also the editing piece. I think shooting sometimes makes me a little nervous. I don't actually love being in front of the camera, and it's something I've had to get used to. But I love that process of thinking of ideas, of really trying to motivate myself, of being creative in that process, and then in editing and kind of combining B-roll and different images. I think that's a really satisfying part of the process. So focus on what you enjoy and really try to have fun with it. I think that's gonna eventually reflect in your videos. My next tip is to appreciate the views and comments you do get. Focus on the positive. It's so easy to compare yourself to other people, to think you're not doing well enough, when really you're doing super well. If you have 300 views, that's 300 people who clicked on your video to watch it. Or say you have 300 subscribers, that is 300 people who not only watched some of your video, but decided to hit the subscribe button and say, I like you enough to be interested to see more from you. And that is huge. Every single subscriber is a living, breathing human being. And I think there's something so exciting about feeling connected to those people. And I think really appreciating the views or the subscribers you do have will help give you that motivation and momentum to keep going. Because there will always be somebody who has more subscribers than you, more views than you. If you only focus on that, then you'll never be excited about what's going on with you. So I just recommend really being appreciative and grateful and excited about the people who are engaging with your content. Because I know I learn a lot from the people who comment or engage with my channel. Speaking of which, if you're new to this channel, I would really appreciate it if you would subscribe. Doing that, as well as liking this video, helps the videos get out to more people, and it's just a natural, organic way to behaviorally support my channel. So if you're willing to do it, I'd really, really appreciate it. My seventh tip is to go with the ebbs and flows. That is normal on YouTube, and I even think there might be something about the algorithm where, you know, you're gonna have videos that do well or do better, and then you're gonna have videos that just don't do well at all. And I definitely find that to be the case. But I think that getting caught up in that and trying to overanalyze that can be problematic. Look at your analytics, see what you can find to inform you about how people are enjoying your videos, what they like, and try to, you know, capitalize on that and try to learn from it. But I also think that if you can step back and still have other things going on in your life that you're excited about and not get kind of bogged down in the ebbs and flows, I think it's way better, because ultimately then YouTube can stay a fun thing in your life as opposed to something that you're like worried about and stressed out about. And I think if you start to get in that cycle of stress, it will reflect in your channel, in the topics, in the content, and how it's coming across. So I definitely think that just being excited about the positive changes and, you know, focusing on other things in your life when it's not going as well, I think is a good strategy for just not letting those ebbs and flows get you down. My eighth piece of advice is don't be afraid to be yourself. Inevitably, you will get negative comments if you keep going on YouTube. Inevitably, people will disagree with you, and that's okay. That's part of the human experience. It's okay to also learn from negative comments, but also maybe if some of them are really hurting your feelings or bothering you, learn to say, you know what, that's okay. They don't have to agree with me. I just definitely think learning to be yourself and being authentic is going to resonate with people way better than trying to be something you're not. And everybody has something to share, no matter what age you are, no matter what background, what culture, you have a group of people that want to hear your voice. And you can do that and you can share it with them. You don't have to wait to get permission. You're worthwhile and you're worth hearing from. So if you're interested in starting that channel, don't be afraid to just be your authentic self, to do things a little differently from other people, and that'll be what makes your channel unique to you. So now I'm gonna really quickly switch over to gear, and I will link everything below. Use the link below to go directly to any of these pieces of gear. I have to say, with all these pieces of gear, there was a lot of trial and error and a lot of research, reading articles, watching YouTube videos to find the right pieces of gear. So if you're planning to start a channel, I do think that hopefully that's one way to expedite the process, just maybe ordering gear, either the gear that I'm using or some other YouTuber whose videos you like, so that you don't have to spend many, many, many countless hours seeing what gear works and what gear works together. Like I said before, I think one of the first things to invest in is a good mic. I'm going to link two below. One is a lav mic, the kind that you pin on your shirt. And that is really good for me for videos, especially if I'm moving around a lot. Like when I did a house tour, I wore that on my shirt so that as I moved around, I didn't have to like carry this shotgun microphone with me. But the shotgun mic I have linked is also really, really good. I think it's the best bang for your buck. Both these really are. That's kind of a theme, I think. Trying to find the best quality at a reasonable price. Of course, gear in general is exorbitantly expensive, but this mic is really, really good, but a little bit more of a doable price than some of the other mics that are out there. And so for cameras, I have a Sony a7R III and a Sony a7 III. And I picked these cameras because I wanted something, again, that was good bang for the buck. I wanted something that was good for both video and photo. I wanted something that could have a high frame rate so that I could do slow-mo, which I think kind of adds a cool element to videos. I also wanted something that was good in low light, especially because I was shooting a lot of weddings. So I think that was important to me. It might not be as important to you, but I think it's beneficial to have a camera that does well in low light. I do think Sony cameras tend to have the stereotype of being not quite as beautiful color-wise as, say, Canon cameras, but I think it was a trade-off I was satisfied with because of all the other elements that the Sony camera had. And I also just figured I can always do color grading in editing, and that Sony had all these other elements at a doable price. And I also liked these mirrorless cameras because they're really physically light. So after a ton of research, those are the cameras I landed on. Sony's coming out with newer cameras and all that, but if you're looking for something that's just doable and does well, I'd recommend checking out the links below. Also, my tripod was actually a pretty recent investment. I had a couple of really crappy tripods in the past, and now that I've gotten this one, I just absolutely love it. It's easy to open up really quickly or take down really quickly. It's very stable. It has a gliding head if you're wanting to do B-roll that moves or kind of like pivot where the camera is and doing video. I think it's a great all-around tripod. It's a little bit more expensive than my previous tripods, but I think if you can swing it, it's worth purchasing this one. I highly recommend it. Check out the link below. I'll also link the lights that I use, which these are just pretty ordinary LED lights. Like I said, I do point them away from me, so I use the reflected light to kind of light up my face. I think they're just solid, good lights. And then I did purchase a small monitor that mounts on top of my camera, and I definitely think this one I really like because it's just a little bit bigger than just using a tiny, tiny one, but it's not overwhelming. It's also not super distracting. I think it's so important when you are making a video, if you can, to try not to look at the monitor like I look directly into the lens, because I feel like also then I'm not distracted by focusing on how weird I look or something. I'm just focused on talking to somebody. Like, I almost feel like at a certain point, when you've done it enough, the camera just becomes almost like a friend, or I think of it as a friend that I'm just talking to, as opposed to, I don't know, looking at the monitor and focusing on what I look like. And I just think I end up feeling more natural when I'm just talking to somebody. But I do think having a monitor is good, because if you're just shooting but you have no idea what the composition of the video is, what's in your background, where you're framed in it, it's gonna cause a lot of problems. So I think getting a good monitor is really important. Again, this one is good bang for your buck, and it can mount right on top of your camera. Pro tip though, if you are gonna get this mount and the shotgun mic that I mentioned before, you probably will want another stand for either the monitor or the mic so that they're both where you need them to be. So that was a lot of information. I think this is gonna probably be a longer video of mine, but I just wanted a video that talked about my journey, since it's been a year and I can't believe it, and I'm excited for the year to come. I figured I'd share some of these ideas because videos like this is how I learned how to create a channel and to get started with it. And so I thought I'd share that information in case anybody's interested. I am all about people lifting each other up and supporting each other, as opposed to trying to be competitive and putting other people down. I think by supporting each other and lifting each other up, we're actually lifting ourselves up, because all boats rise at high tide. I definitely think that the more we can support each other, the more we can believe in each other and communicate, the more successful we'll all be. But just remember, if you want to start a channel, just get started with it. Don't worry about the people in your life that might find your channel and whether they'll judge it. I think in life, we just need to stop worrying so much what people think and just do the things that we love, whether it's a YouTube channel or something else in your life. Anyway, if you're interested in more videos like this where I talk about my process and that sort of thing, definitely let me know in the comments below. I don't really know if this type of topic is of interest to anybody here, but I thought it would be kind of fun to just look back, think about what I've learned, and share it. It's definitely been a process where I create videos and I look back and I think, oh, I could have done that a lot better, and I'm learning constantly. So hopefully this coming year, I will also be able to improve my process even more. Also in the comments, let me know if you're thinking about starting a channel, or if there's some new endeavor in your life that you're wanting to try, and how you're kind of engaging with it and getting started with it. That's all I've got for you, but thanks so much for watching, and I hope you have a wonderful rest of your day. Bye.